Another spirit that is part of the evil, wicked, selfish, stubborn, and jealous spirit is the greedy, miserly, ungiving spirit. 2 Peter 2:3. In their greed, these teachers will exploit you with stories they have made up. Their condemnation has long been hanging over them, and their destruction has been sleeping. Luke 12:15. Then he said to them, watch out! Be on your guard against all kinds of greed. Man's life does not consist in the abundance of his possessions. Isaiah 57:17. I was enraged by his sinful greed. I punished him and hid my face in anger. Yet he kept on in his willful ways. Matthew 23:25. Woe to you, teachers of the law and Pharisees, you hypocrites! You clean the outside of the cup and dish, but you inside, they are full of greed and self-indulgence. Matthew 23:25. Woe to you, teachers of the law and Pharisees. Habakkuk 2:5. Wealth is a treacherous, and the arrogant are never at rest. They open their mouths as wide as the grave, and like death they are never satisfied. In their greed they have gathered up many nations and swallowed many peoples. Psalms 57:4. I am surrounded by fierce lions, who greedily devour human prey, whose teeth pierce like spears and arrows, and whose tongues cut like swords. Proverbs 1:19. Such is the fate of all who are greedy for gain. It ends up robbing them of life. Proverbs 21:26. They are always greedy for more. All the godly love to give. Proverbs 28:22. A greedy person tries to get rich quick, but it only leads to poverty. A person who is wealthy, evil, wicked, greedy, miserly, ungiving spirit is so oppressed they are even greedy towards their own children. Their worldly wealth causes them to mock others, and they are so glad of their worldly wealth, but in the end, it will sting them like an injected in its deadly poison. A person dwelt with this evil, wicked spirit has greed that is so deep as the black holes in space. This wicked spirit is extremely dangerous and deadly. A greedy spirit tends to occupy itself in the black scorpion. We know from the Bible that evil spirits sometimes occupy the bodies of animals. Of course, a black scorpion is not an animal, but it is a very deadly creature. And when the particular evil spirit crosses over from the spiritual world into a body, it prefers the body of a black scorpion. This is why it is very important for a person to stay as far away as possible from a black scorpion. Oh, like the sting of greed. The sting of the black scorpion is extremely deadly. Greediness is also one of the seven deadly sins. A greedy, miserly, ungiving spirit becomes drunk with any amount of material wealth, hurrying away with the wealth. They believe they are conquerors, neglecting God. They have fulfilled their own will, and they will also neglect man's laws to fulfill their own will. Excess cruelty is sometimes used in order for this person to fulfill their greed. Their greed is like a drunkard flushed with alcohol. Greedy ambition causes them to be restless, unable to sleep very well, and constantly worried about future loss. This wicked spirit is able to become whatever the greedy, miserly person loves. A ruling passion soaks a greedy, miserly person's entire being until they become a cruel savage that is all appetite. Grasping to devour the whole world, they open their greedy, miserly mouth beyond measure. Isaiah 5:14. Hell hath enlarged her soul and opened her mouth beyond measure. There is no end to their greed as it grows and becomes bigger and wider. Growing bigger and wider, it is never satisfied. It cannot be satisfied. Ecclesiastes 5:10. He that loves silver shall not be satisfied with silver. Nothing the greedy, miserly person wants can ever satisfy the greedy, miserly person's soul. Constantly, their soul wants more and more things of this world that are fleeting. The more they get, the prouder they become. The more they get, the more despisable they become. The more they get, the more empty they become. Oh, like a bottomless pit. Anything that falls into them is never enough. It's never enough. It's never enough. They take one step forward, trying to grasp and obtain everything within their reach. And then they take 10 steps backwards, wanting more and more and more. Misery! Misery will besiege them as there is no limit to their insatiable greed! Oh, when Jesus walked the earth, he came upon two different types of people. There were those who were true believers and had great faith in him, and there were those who were greedy, miserly, and vain glory! The latter were emperors of Rome and enemies to Christ. They lived in all kinds of luxuries, addicted to all kinds of vices, and they spent a great amount of money on their luxuries, lifestyles. Roman emperors of Jesus' day could never be satisfied. Their riches, honor, power, and monarchy only brought them a more insatiable thirst they could never satisfy. All the nations were subject to the Roman Empire, but it was never enough. It was never enough to satisfy their wide open mouths. The Romans were very proud, very powerful, and extremely greedy. Soon they found that all their riches were but thick clay of silver and gold earth. They overloaded themselves with this thick clay of silver and gold dirt that eventually brought them down to their fall of destruction. Their journey through life was full of dirt that brought a great amount of guilt and worry and never satisfied their souls. Greedy of gain, they troubled their families, their friends, and themselves. They brought a curse from God upon themselves and the complete ruin of the Roman Empire. The greatest tragedy is the ruin they brought upon their own souls. Those who pursue worldly riches, possessions, and earthly glory often find themselves disappointed. It is only God who fills the whole earth and can satisfy the soul. During the days of Jesus, another similar group of people called the Pharisees and scribes were very greedy and miserly. They were full of extortion and excess. Going through great pains, they would make sure to look good on the outside, but on the inside, they were full of extortion and greed. And Jesus said it to their face. They appeared clean on the outside as they went through great pains to make sure of purifications prescribed by law, but on the inside, they stunk with greed. The Pharisees and scribes were very particular in making sure the cups and the platters they drank and ate from were very clean. They have a law concerning the washing of dishes, which had several rules about which they were washed and was washed in the manner of washing. All washing was strictly observed, and outward cleanliness they considered extremely important. However, the food and drink that they placed in the dishes were obtained by extorting the poor and the needy through injustice, fraud, and trickery. Jesus warned them. Jesus said it right to their face. He said, "Woe to you, scribes and Pharisees, you hypocrites, for you make the clean the outside of the cup and the platter, but within you are full of extortion and excess." The great message from Jesus Christ is the importance of having a pure heart versus looking good on the outside and having an abundance of wealth and power. An evil, wicked spirit of greed and miserliness is an enemy to the gospel of Jesus Christ and the salvation of one's soul. It causes a person to strain at small matters the size of a gnat that don't really count, while swallowing larger matters the size of a camel that really count. What good is it for the person to be clean on the outside but filthy with greed on the inside? The Apostle Paul described some people during his day who preached the gospel as doing it for filthy lucre's sake. They were motivated to preach the gospel due to greed and the want of money and not for the sake of Christ. God said he would withdraw all his spirit from those who preached and spread the gospel that was motivated by greed or for filthy lucre's sake. Those who preach the gospel to satisfy a greedy desire for worldly possessions and self-seeking will be held accountable to the living God. Ungoverned miserliness and greed will make a person like a troubled sea. They will be a terror of conscience brought upon most that will gratify, disturb their ability to enjoy their possessions. A person dwelt by this evil, wicked, greedy, miserly, ungiving spirit will receive no healing by God's grace and mercy. A greedy person's comfort will not depend on their affluence and their property, will not add one day to their life. The word covetous is often used to describe a person whose greedy desires cause hurt to others. There are many persons who devote their whole life to chasing after their greedy desires, and they do not care who gets hurt in the process. Greediness strikes at the very root of the riches evil. A counselor attempts to help this person by showing them the kingdom of Christ, what is described throughout the New Testament and the Bible. The kingdom of Christ is not of this world. It is a spiritual kingdom, and its dominion is founded in grace. The rewards of being a follower of Jesus Christ do not consist of worldly advantages that satisfy the flesh. A worldly person has no regard for the providence of God. A counselor helps this person recognize, then understand how uncertain human affairs are in this world, and instead the importance and certainty of eternity and the worth of a person's soul. Counseling encourages this person to do good for others instead of indulging in their flesh and gratifying their sensual appetite. It is folly. It is folly for a person to pursue only that which satisfies the body and only lasts a short time, while neglecting the things that satisfy God that last for eternity. A greedy, miserly, ungiving person has faith and hope that they may get money, which they plan to spend to satisfy their lust. The person who has their eyes set upon Jesus places their hope and faith in Jesus, and they will receive salvation, and they plan to spend eternity in the kingdom of heaven. A person who has no other view except glorifying themselves and gathering riches for themselves in the end will be condemned. The counselor points out that God does not slumber, and his justice is not asleep, and he watches over us and will bring damnation upon those who are greedy and miserly. Being a greedy and miserly person only hurts oneself. The ruler of the world seduces with false words and false desires, deceiving the hearts of many and condemning them to the wrath of God. Greediness and miserliness are works of darkness in the character of the old man that offends God. Although the greedy, miserly person's worldly possessions appear to be fruitful, God will turn their few worthless fruits into barrenness, ashes, and rot. During the counseling process, this person learns to rest in a quietness like the lilies of the field, which Jesus describes and encourages us to consider. They do not toil or spin, and likewise we can be like the lily that has no struggle or anxiety about its future. In order to be like lilies in the field, a person must rest their faith and hope in the Lord. The counselor encourages this person to allow Christ to reveal himself through them, to allow his beauty and glory to shine through them, and they will not be consumed with the things of this world. Instead of walking around with the image of a miserable, greedy miser, it is better to walk around with the image of Jesus Christ upon one's soul. The counselor encourages this person to pray often, and they will keep this evil, wicked spirit from having us toil and spin. By keeping a strong faith and trust in Jesus Christ, we will find rest. A counselor helps a person realize that their resources are limited and they only have so much time, money, and energy, and their worldly appetite is insatiable. No matter how much they gain or achieve, they will always want more. None of us can always get what we want, and making ourselves unhappy, frustrated, and miserable because we don't get what we want is frugal. Greed is one of the major causes of a person's suffering in this world today. We all have desires because we are flesh and live in a physical world. Having desires is perfectly normal, but having excessive desires is abnormal and usually causes a lot of pain and suffering. Money is not evil in and of itself, but the love of money is evil. Look at 1 Timothy 6:10. For the love of money is the root of all evil, which while some coveted after, they have erred from the faith and pierced themselves through many sorrows. A person becomes greedy because they learn that having certain possessions will bring pleasure, and they have fear that there will not be enough to go around for everyone, so they better get as much as they can before it all disappears. Although it appears that there will not be enough to go around for everyone, fear that there will not be enough causes greed. Greed causes more fear. Fear causes greed. And greed causes more fear. A person who has dwelt the evil, wicked, greedy, miserly, ungiving spirit is able to give up any amount of their money, no matter how much excess they have. They won't give up one stinking cent. If they are famous, they are unable to give up any amount of their fame, and if they have power, they are unable to give up any amount of their power. They tightly grip to those things and become prisoners of their greed, shaking with fear of ever letting go. The lottery, get-quick-rich schemes, and credit cards trap this person in a net with false promises of striking it rich, and or they can get what they want now. They become fools trying to fulfill their insatiable appetite. A greedy, miserly person may work extremely hard, but they have a lack of self-control and they neglect the things that really matter, such as spending time with the family. Before they know it, their life is over, and the things that really matter, such as spending time with the family, are all gone. But the thing is for sure, one thing is for sure, no matter how much they have, they will always want more. A lifetime was spent building a fortune, and in the end they find their desires are endless and they have no loving relationship. The counselor encourages a person to be more compassionate, self-disciplined, help towards others, nurturing, and more responsible. The world says that greed is a good and it is acceptable. That's a lie straight from hell. Many will marry someone they have never met and have never dated because they are a millionaire. And the world not only says that it's okay, but it is encouraged. They even make television shows about it. This is all false and lies. It comes straight from the evil one. Greed is never good. Greed is never good, and it has no good purpose, and it seldom brings any lasting satisfaction. It causes a person to ignore the needs of others, to take advantage of others, to commit crimes and hurt others, and to plunge right into destruction. Many people fall victim to this horribly wicked evil spirit and go about trying to acquire material possessions in hopes that it will satisfy them and oppress their neighbors. The more materialistic a person becomes, the more insecure and inadequate they become. A person may think that they are a complete loser because they don't drive a big fancy car or live in a big fancy house or wear expensive fancy clothes. That is so far from the truth. However, the opposite is often true, because those who have the big fancy car, house, and clothes are slaves to their desires and pleasures and full of all kinds of evil, wicked envy. Luke 12:15. Then Jesus said, beware, don't be greedy for what you don't have. Real life is not measured by how much we own. Those who are greedy and miserly are swimming in an ocean of stink. A counselor does their best to convince this person to redirect their desires towards benefiting others in order to be free from this evil, wicked spirit. And they are encouraged to practice generosity versus greed. God sees a person's greediness and miserliness, and it is foul before God. A materially poor person can be just as greedy as a very materially rich person. Exodus 20:17. You shall not covet your neighbor's house. You shall not covet your neighbor's wife or his male servant or his female servant or his ox or his doggy or anything that belongs to your neighbor. Luke 18:22. And when Jesus heard this, he said to him, one thing you still lack. Sell all that you possess and distribute it to the poor, and you shall have treasure in heaven, and come follow me. But when he heard these things, he became very sad, for he was extremely rich. 1 Timothy 6:17. Instruct those who are rich in this present world not to be conceited or to fix their hope on the uncertainty of riches, but on God, who richly supplies us with all these things to enjoy. Matthew 6:19. Do not lay up yourselves treasures upon the earth, where moth and rust destroy, and where thieves break in and steal, but lay up yourselves treasures in heaven, where neither moth nor rust destroys, and where thieves do not break in and steal. For where your treasure is, there will be your heart also. A person is encouraged by the counselor to fix their eyes upon Jesus, who gives us the gift of the eternal life. The things of this world are fragile and are here today, gone tomorrow. No matter how much money a person has, it cannot buy salvation. It is only our faith in Christ that we receive eternal salvation. The belt of truth is this, that there are those who, in their greed, will exploit us with stories they have made up. Their condemnation has long been hanging over us, and their destruction has not been sleeping. Oh, we know that it is important to watch out and be on our guard against all kinds of greed. A person's life does not consist in the abundance of his possessions. The belt of truth is that the Lord our God becomes enraged by a person's sinful greed. God will punish them and by his face in anger, yet the greedy stubbornly keeps their eyes on their willful ways. The Lord Jesus said, woe to you teachers of the law and Pharisees, you hypocrites. You clean out the outside of the cup and the dish, but on the inside you are full of greed and self-indulgence. We know that wealth is treacherous and the arrogant are never at rest. They open their mouths as wide as the grave and like death. They are never satisfied. In their greed, they have gathered up many nations and swallowed many people. The belt of truth is that we are surrounded by fierce lions who greedily devour human prey, whose teeth pierce like spears and arrows, and whose tongues cut like swords. We know that it is the fate of all who are greedy for gain. It ends up robbing them of life. They are always greedy for more. Always greedy for more and more and more and more. While the godly love to give. We know that a greedy person tries to get rich quick, but in the end, it only leads to poverty. The Lord commands us that we shall not covet our neighbor's house. We shall not covet our neighbor's spouse or their male servant or their female servant or their ox or their donkey or anything that belongs to our neighbor. We know that Jesus said to the rich man, one thing you still laugh, sell all your possessions and distribute it to the poor, and you shall have treasures in heaven, and come follow me. But when he heard these things, he became very sad, for he was extremely rich. Belt of truth is that we are materially rich in this world, should not be conceited or to fix our hope on the uncertainty of riches, but on God, who richly supplies us with all things to enjoy. The Lord said, do not lay up yourselves treasures upon the earth, where moth and rust destroy, and where thieves break in and steal, but lay up yourselves treasures in heaven, where neither moth nor rust destroys, and where thieves do not break in and steal. For where your treasure is, there will your heart be also. Let's pray. Father, I thank you for everything I have received in this world. Forgive me, Lord, for being greedy, miserly, and ungiving. I confess that there have been times when I could have given more, but chose not to give more. Thank you, Lord, for everything you have given me. Help me, Lord, to know that only you can satisfy my soul. I know, Lord, that the things of this world do not satisfy. The more I seek you, the more satisfied I will be. When I become worried about the things of this world, Lord, I pray for this and that. Lord, help me to consider the lilies in the field. Father, I thank you for giving me a pure heart and being less concerned about how I look on the outside. I pray in the precious name of Jesus. Amen. Another spirit that is part of the selfish, stubborn, jealous spirit is the evil, wicked, narcissistic, self-centered spirit. Romans 12:3, for by the grace given me, I say to every one of you, do not think of yourselves more highly than you ought, but rather think of yourselves with sober judgment in accordance with the measure of faith God has given you. 2 Corinthians 10:12, oh, don't worry, we wouldn't dare say that. We are so wonderful as these other men who tell you how important they are, but they are only comparing themselves with each other, using themselves as the standard of measurement. How ignorant! Philippians 2:3, do nothing out of the selfish ambition of vain conceit, but in humility consider others better than yourself. A person who has dwelt the evil, wicked, narcissistic, self-centered spirit believes they are extremely special and that they have an extraordinary sense of entitlement. No matter how much this position in life, they believe they are extremely superior to others. Even if they are lying in a ditch, they will go through great measure to convince others that they are extremely special and entitled. If anyone challenges this person, they become extremely upset and angry. This is known as a narcissistic wound. Not once did Jesus ever act like this. Not once did Jesus ever act like he was special and better than others and entitled. His character was completely opposite of the character of a person who is dwelt by this evil, wicked, a narcissistic, self-centered spirit. This person has a vain and hollow shell, as portrayed by having an extremely vain opinion of themselves. They believe they should get all the attention, all the praise, all the honor, and be treated extremely special. This person is all about self, and they constantly want to exhibit how talented and special they think they are, showing their conceits and self-valuation and want others to believe that they are extremely important and special. Humbleness and humility are not part of their vocabulary. They cannot see the defects that they have or believe that they have any defects. Most of us humbly bow down before the Lord and understand that we are not worthy, while the narcissistic self-centered person jumps up and down and screams out to God that they are worthy. When they see others are in a honorable office, they believe they are the one who deserves to be in the honorable office. Blind to defects of themselves, they constantly point out the defects of others. A person who has dwelt this evil, wicked, narcissistic, self-centered spirit seldom is a follower of Christ unless they are placed in a very special position within the church. Not because they earned it, but because they have convinced others of how special they are and that they deserve to be in a very important position. Their interest is not in others or in Christ. Self-love, specialness, and a deep sense of entitlement consumes their soul. This person will go out of their way to promote their own reputation and always prefer themselves over others. If they do belong to a church, they will convince others that nobody is more devoted to God than they are. Unfortunately, that God is themselves. It is doubtful, though, that this person would ever be a follower of Christ or a member of a church. A person dwelt with this wicked spirit often believes those who worship and believe in God are weak. The narcissistic, self-centered person desires praises from others, which is directly opposite of loving God. They are extremely resistant to esteeming others better than themselves and are consistently exalting themselves. The person dwelt with this evil, wicked spirit loves to talk about themselves all the time. They always talk about all their accomplishments. They talk about how excellent they are. If they just honk, honk, honk their horn all the time, they will undervalue others immediately who they see as inferior, and they see themselves as the standard of superior excellence. The Lord says that type of person is not wise, as they measure themselves to themselves and compare themselves to themselves. Always bragging and boasting and thinking highly of themselves, they leave nothing to nothing. When counseling this person, the counselor stresses that self-flattery is not good, and instead of praising oneself, this person should strive to give God the glory in their salvation and humbly thank Him for His love and forgiveness and the abilities to promote His glory. Instead of trying to get honor from man, we should strive to get honor from God. A common theme throughout the Bible is that we are not to overestimate ourselves or think more of ourselves than we ought to. God does not judge a person by their talents, their rank, their wealth, or function. God judges us by our Christian character and could care less about our titles, accomplishments, and everything else. A person who possesses a Christian character is humble, modest. They think soberly. They act wisely according to God's wisdom. They're prudent, and they think of others. A counselor convinces this person that God is the giver, and whatever talents and abilities they have are given to them strictly by God. During the counseling process, this person begins to realize that anything they accomplish or create is not dependent upon them, but it is a gift of God, and God is the source. The same with the counselor. They model what they teach, and that any healing that occurs in the counseling process is not dependent upon the counselor, but it is a gift of God, and God is the source of healing. It is impossible for a person who is dwelling narcissistic, self-centered, evil, wicked spirit to be any worth as a counselor. By modeling faith and confidence and trust in God, there will be a better chance of the narcissistic, self-centered person to change. On the day of judgment, we will be judged according to our relationship with Christ Jesus and nothing else. Christ Jesus, it's all about Him and nothing else. A counselor also must admit and understand that they do not possess the whole faith of the gospel, but only a small measure. This high-minded, narcissist, conceited, self-centered person has no respect for the difference in gifts that each person receives. Well, what qualifies a person to have a spiritual insight, to be a good teacher, a prophet, a preacher of the gospel, has nothing to do with education and number of degrees obtained. It has everything to do with a person's faith in Christ Jesus. Faith is what develops a person's true character, and it is a determining element of measure. Those who are close to this person who has dwelt this evil, wicked, narcissistic, self-centered spirit usually go away feeling angry or sad after they have contact. Interacting with this person usually leaves one feeling confused and bewildered. The person of this person can be compared to that of a four-year child. They are extremely hypersensitive to criticism. They lack a sense of humor. They are impulsive. They are a great deal about their appearance, and they are very critical of others. Oftentimes in a relationship, they can be very deceitful. They will deny saying something they just said, and if you disagree with them about anything, they take it extremely serious. A primary problem with the person who is dwelt by this evil, wicked spirit is that they have absolutely no empathy for others. Because they lack empathy, they have a difficult time understanding context and effect. In a discussion, when the other person is angry, they don't get it. They don't understand the context of why the other person is angry. It is like they are completely disconnected and only hear words as evidence by going off on several tangents that are completely unrelated and irrelevant. Like a four-year-old child, they only know how to pay attention to things that affect them personally. Since they don't pay any attention to what affects others, they do not take other people's feelings into consideration. Their conscience has not matured. The only thing that gets the narcissistic self-person's attention is any threat of punishment or any threat of making them not look good. Being seen as perfect, superior, infallible, and godlike is very important to them. And if they do not see it this way, they see themselves as completely worthless. There is no middle ground. However, it is difficult for them to ever believe that they could ever do anything wrong. A counselor must keep in mind that if they confront the narcissistic self-centered person, they will oftentimes return with insults, contempt, threats, and sometimes they become physically violent. It is not uncommon for them to place the counselor upon a pedestal and then call them all kinds of horrible names, and that they are nothing, and then immediately go back to placing the counselor on a pedestal. When the narcissistic self-centered person seeks counseling, they will want to know all the degrees, all the credentials the counselor has. It is unlikely that they would even consider a counselor who has less than a doctorate degree, even though they didn't even graduate from high school themselves. The narcissistic person often says that others just need to accept them the way they are, and if not, they will threaten to banish them. them from their wonderful presence. When the narcissist feels what they consider love, it comes in the form of being terrified of somebody. This person is extremely excessive and sneaky. They think they have the absolute perfect power, that they are beautiful, and that they know everything. They pretend their pretend image that they have fallen in love with. They believe others should be in love with and adore also. When or if a person dwelt with the narcissistic self-centered spirit joins a church, they are very much attracted to Calvinism. The reason they are attracted to Calvinism is because of the Calvinistic belief that God chose certain people before they were born and that certain people are very special to God. This feeds right into the narcissistic person's mind as they believe that they are God's special favorite. Many churches in this modern world thrive on building a member's self-esteem and trying to make them feel good. And no one seems to care about getting the true word of God as long as the minister makes them feel good about themselves, makes them feel wanted, and makes them want to go to church. Seldom does this narcissistic self-centered person laugh. They don't get jokes, humor, or comedy. However, they love being sarcastic towards others and consider themselves witty, but they have absolutely no sense of humor. The amount of entitlements and privileges and indulgences this person expects is incredible. Also, they feel entitled to exploit others without any reciprocation. When they go shopping for clothes, they look for trademarks as long as the clothing has a prestigious trademark. It goes with them and their thoughts about themselves. In intimate relationships, they do not want to do what the other person wants to do because it is too much like sharing. They will go out of their way not to do what the other person wants to do. The other person is there to give them what they want, but they do not believe they have any obligation to give the other person what they want in return. Normally, the relationship is only one way and only goes in one direction, which is the narcissistic self-centered person takes and the person they're in a relationship gives. The narcissistic self-centered person takes, and the other person just gives. If and when the other person starts demanding that the self-centered person also give in return, the relationship will soon be over because the self-centered shell is not the least bit interested in a two-way relationship. Oftentimes, a narcissistic self-centered individual will go to be a particular item that they eat that rarely anyone else eats because they think if they eat something that nobody else eats, it makes them special. For instance, they may eat frogs. One way this person likes to have fun is to stir up somebody's expectation, then go out of their way to disappoint them. They expect others to give them everything they want, but they will not go out of their way to give others what they want. They will even find things laying around the house that they no longer use and wrap them up and give others for Christmas presents. Surprisingly, they would even wrap up something that is lying around the house and belongs to the person they give the gift to. In an intimate relationship, it is better to not tell the narcissistic self-centered person what you want, and you would have a better chance of getting it. Oftentimes, this person will find a mate who will indulge in their every whim, cater to whatever they want, and agree with their views no matter what. There are occasions that they will be charming, nice, and even flattering, but it is only to manipulate a person into giving them what they want. The only time they are accommodating in a relationship is when they are afraid of the person. When they tell their mate that they have realized their thoughts have not treated them right, or they are sorry they took advantage, it is all a bunch of phony baloney, and they are getting ready to do something really horrible and nasty. They always seem to find a person to exploit who does things out of the goodness of their heart. Oh, how lucky they think the other person is to serve them. A person who has dwelt evil, wicked, narcissistic, self-seeking spirit cannot begin or increase serving God until they decrease serving self. It is not possible to serve two masters, and as Jesus spoke, no man can serve two masters, for either he will hate the one and love the other, or else he will hold to the one and despise the other. Ye cannot serve mammon. To worship God, a person must sacrifice worship of self. They must empty themselves of others, and they must empty themselves of the world. The denying of self daily was a common theme preached by Jesus during his walk on this earth. A person who remains completely wrapped up in themselves daily is unable to perceive God. God doesn't depend upon any person. A person who is self-willed seeks to gain their own answers, is self-indulgent, and believes the world revolves around them, is self-centered. word. The counselor assists this person by helping them see how important it is to have wisdom that comes from God, how wise it is to govern their restrain one's appetite, how heeding to one's desire is humble, how the humble are slow to get angry, how tenderness and charity lead to a contented heart, how patience brings purity, and how forgiveness is noble. This self-centered person is full of lust, strong opinions, prejudices, and an unlimited appetite. If they gave up self or denied themselves in their mind, they would be giving up the center of the universe and the rest of the world. Oh, would not have anything to revolve around. A person who has dwelt the evil, wicked, narcissistic, self-centered spirit is usually very prejudiced, racist, and stereotypes others. They have preferences and are unable to be partial when dealing with others. Since they are very prejudiced, they seem to be always on the attack or on the defense in order to conceal and guard their prejudices, believing that they are supreme to other races, other socioeconomic groups, and others who are different. They are disillusioned and walk in darkness. Since this person has the delusion that they are supreme and extremely special, they are considered their children to be a supreme and extremely special. They teach their children all about self-love, believing only in self. They are superior to other groups, and that there is all about obtaining luxury, that life is all about obtaining luxury and pleasure, disillusioning their children with dreams of material riches and worldliness. The roots of the evil, wicked, narcissistic, self-centered spirit grows deep within them, and they will reap the harvest of their own sowing within extremely self-centered, greedy, narcissistic children. A person who has dwelt this evil, wicked spirit and is intoxicated with self has a future of pain, sorrow, and an aching heart. Through the power of the Almighty God, a person dwelt with this evil, wicked spirit can pass through the dark gate of sorrow that the worship of self has brought them. Only through the Spirit of God can they achieve peace. They will no longer suffer grief when their will does not come to pass, because they now trust in God's will. This person, through the power of the Almighty God, lets go of self and is no longer upset when others disappoint them, is no longer extremely sorrowful when they make a minor mistake, and they are no longer completely overwhelmed when someone says something negative about them. Matthew 18:3. Verily I say unto you, except ye be converted and become as little children, ye shall not enter the kingdom of heaven. Jesus Christ is God's chief messenger. He was God in the flesh. He was the greatest teacher that ever lived. He possessed the deepest truth of God. When Jesus spoke, oftentimes he began by saying the word verily, 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 which basically means you better stop and listen. A person who has dwelt the evil, wicked, narcissistic, self-centered spirit is completely preoccupied with themselves. They are in love with their own image. They are only concerned about how things affect them. The person needs to understand that they were born a no-good, unrighteous sinner. There is not much to idolize about self, because we are born in a fallen state. The Lord tells us not to look at our own interests, but to look at the interest of others. Philippians 2:4, look not only to your own interest, but also to the interest of others. A major problem with having a narcissistic, self-centered character trait is it blinds a person to their fallen sinful nature. It leads a person to cause harm to others in order to satisfy the lust of their own flesh. A person dwelt with this evil, wicked spirit often says, well, I'm good and I have a good heart. If asked if they are going to heaven, they will often say, I'm going to go to heaven because I'm a good person. I'm going to go to heaven because I'm a good person. I'm going to go to heaven because I'm a good person. The counselor would quickly rebuke anyone who says this, as it is extremely narcissistic and self-centered to say or to believe that one is going to heaven because they are a good person. The counselor must quickly correct this person that the only way they are going to heaven is through the blood and sacrifice of the redeeming Savior, and it has absolutely nothing to do with their goodness. Romans 7:5. We are slaves to the flesh until we place our faith in Jesus, who sets the captives free. The world encourages narcissism and self-centeredness. Secular counseling, especially today, considers many psychological problems to be a result of low self-esteem or low self-worth. It is not it is not uncommon for secular counselors to encourage too much self-love and often encourage those they counsel to love themselves to a great degree. They also commonly encourage people to live their life any way they want and that they will improve by themselves because they are a great person and they are good and they are bulletproof. That does not go with God's word. It goes against the truth of God that says that we are to do nothing out of selfish ambition. Philippians 2:3. Do nothing out of selfish ambition or vain conceit, but in humility consider others better than yourselves. This probably upsets many secular counselors as it goes against much of what they teach, and because they do not know Jesus. They do not understand because they do not know Jesus. They do not understand that the usual problem with a person who suffers from a low self-worth or low self-esteem is that they believe in themselves. They are the center of the universe and they have no faith in God. Displacing God from the center and considering oneself more important than others is a primary source of low self-esteem. This person often feels worthless and has low self-esteem because they are drowning themselves in a pool of distorted reflections. It is by letting go of oneself that one realizes how much they are loved and treasured by God. A person must empty themselves and lay aside their glory of self with humbleness. 2 Timothy 3:1. But know this, that in the last days perilous times will come, for men will be lovers of themselves. Underneath the facade of self-love, a person who has dwelt with this evil wicked spirit is full of self-hate towards their true selves. They are in love with a reflection or a projected image of themselves that is a false self. A primary source that is used to maintain this self is money. Therefore, it is not uncommon that this person is extremely greedy and miserly. Without money, they could not have the symbols that they crave to feed their self-false reflection in order to maintain the self-image they surround themselves with. Having a nice house, a nice car, nice clothes, they want others to adorn and worship the ground they walk on, to see how great they are, and to serve them. Money and power enables them to achieve social approval and justifies their sense of entitlement. This person believes they are entitled to other people's money and that they should not have to work for it. They use all kinds of deceits, cons, and trickery to sucker people out of giving them money which they believe they are entitled. This feeds their extremely gross grandiosity and leads them to use others and spend their money. The counselor must understand that boasting in oneself and glorifying oneself often leads a person up feeling inferior and not to increasing their self-esteem. A person who is more sensitive to criticism usually has an inflated sense of self-worth. Those who appear to be more of anything in comparison to a person dwelt with this evil, wicked, narcissistic, self-centered spirit are considered an enemy. They would never think of having a spouse who has a better job or makes more money than they do. Those who are dwelt this evil, wicked spirit are usually men versus women. Approximately 80% of those who are dwelt this evil, wicked spirit are men, living in their fantasy of power and brilliance. This person is extremely threatened if their spouse fears in any way to be more intelligent, more successful, or more of anything. They would rather die than have a spouse that's more intelligent. A person who has dwelt this evil, wicked, narcissistic, self-centered spirit has no respect for authority, and they consider themselves the authority on everything. They have a hard time bowing down to the authority of God. Any authority who attempts to hold them accountable in their mind will be destroyed. Their own authority is the only authority they believe counts, and they will just as easily become a mob boss or a CEO of a large company. Either way, they will demand complete and total obedience from those they rule. Because of their extreme sense of entitlement, they are often ungrateful and unthankful towards others. If someone does something extra nice for them, they believe it is because they are entitled to it and that they deserve it. Others are supposed to serve them, so why should they be thankful? In their mind, they believe others should be thankful that they had the opportunity to serve them. When the counselor confronts them and points out that they are unthankful and grateful, this person will become extremely outraged. No matter how much money and power this person has, God has more power. Love, wisdom, respect, compassion, and all the fruits of God's spirit will crush the head of the evil, wicked, narcissistic, self-centered spirit. The person usually grew up in a home where they felt unloved and abandoned. They did not experience much love in their home, which causes them to lack the ability to love others or themselves. In order to cope, they develop a false idealized self to master feelings of being unlovable. The remedy is for them to realize how much God loves them, and there is no greater love than what Jesus did when he died on the cross. They must realize that only Jesus was perfect when he walked this earth. It is okay to strive for perfection, but that cannot be one's God. Every individual is unique and special to God, but they are not unique and special compared to others. The Lord says that we are all equal, and we are all brothers and sisters. This person must realize that their power compared to God's is insignificant. God created the entire universe, and this person can barely balance their bank account. The counselor must be very careful when working with this person, because the slightest perceived insult, disagreement, or criticism, and this person will fly into a narcissistic rage. How dare anybody criticize them? How dare anybody reject them in any way? This person will be unforgiving and will obsessively try to get revenge for even the smallest slight, whether it is real or whether it is imagined. There is no such thing as a constructive criticism for this person who has dwelt the narcissistic self-centered spirit. No matter how helpful the counselor is trying to be, it will be magnified to the extreme due to the counselor trying to help this person perceiving a small slight or criticism or the counselor disagreeing with them. They will develop a plan to completely destroy the counselor's reputation, punishing them and devaluing them without any mercy. When dealing with this person, the counselor must be extremely strong, authoritative, and put the fear of God in this person. A person who has dwelt this evil, wicked, narcissistic, self-centered spirit will not respond positively to any counselor unless they are extremely fearful of the counselor. The counselor must put the fear of God in this person. If not, they will completely destroy the counselor. A counselor must be able to cause this narcissistic, self-centered person to be fearful of them as well as God. And at the same time, the counselor cannot be abusive or disrespectful. There is no room for a counselor as perceived by this person as wimpy. The best way for a counselor to learn how to work with and counsel this person is by reading the book of Isaiah. Isaiah, who was one of Jesus' favorite prophets, and Jesus quoted Isaiah quite often. The counselor approaches this person during counseling the way they would expect the prophet Isaiah to approach them. A counselor must try to model and imitate the prophet Isaiah when counseling the narcissistic person. This does not mean that the counselor pretends to be a prophet. However, it means the counselor must be direct, strong, forceful, and put the fear of God in this narcissistic, self-centered person. There was no one better to put the fear of God in people than the prophet Isaiah. Here is an example. Isaiah 48:1. Hear me, my people. You swear allegiance to the Lord without meaning a word of it. When you boast of living in the holy city and brag about depending on the God of Israel. Time and again, I told you what was going to happen in the future. My words were scarcely spoken when suddenly I did just what I said. I knew how hard and obstinate you are. Your necks are as unbending as iron. You are as hard-headed as brass. That is why I told you ahead of time what I was going to do, so that you can never say, my idol did it. My carved image commanded it to happen. You have heard my predictions and seen them fulfilled, but you refuse to agree to it. So now I will tell you new things I have mentioned before, secrets you haven't heard. Then you can't say, we knew all the time. Psychoexor spiritual counselor has to understand that this is the only approach to use when working with a person who has dwelt with evil, wicked, narcissistic, self-centered spirit. A counselor keeps in mind that a good session is when this individual walks out of the session and feels like the counselor ripped their heart open, and they have a sense of fear towards God and the counselor. Nothing else will ever even come close to penetrating this spirit in this person. The counselor may raise their voice and shout as the person, but they do not degrade them or call them names. Telling a person they are obstinate and as hard-headed as brass is not being abusive. It is telling them the truth. When the counselor tells a person that they are stupid, then they are being abusive. A counselor is encouraged to read the entire book of Isaiah and memorize certain scriptures they can use when counseling this evil, wicked, narcissistically oppressed person. For example, Isaiah 46:12. Listen to me, you stubborn evil man! Isaiah 10:15, but the Lord says, shall the axe boast greater power than the man who uses it? Isaiah 22:19. Yes, I will drive you out of the office as the Lord and pull you down from your high position. Isaiah 25:1. Oh Lord, I will honor and praise your name, for you are my God. You do such wonderful things. Isaiah 25:1. Oh Lord, I will honor and praise your name, for you are my God. You do such wonderful things. Isaiah 26:4. Trust in the Lord God always, for in the Lord Jehovah is your everlasting strength. He humbles the proud and brings the haughty city to the dust. Its walls will come down. Its walls will come down crashing. He presents it to the poor and needy for their use. Isaiah 29:15. Oh, to those who try to hide their plans from God, who try to keep him in the dark concerning what they do. God can't see us, they say to themselves. He doesn't know what is going on. How stupid can they be? Isn't he the potter greater than you, the jars he makes? Will you say to him, he didn't make us? Does a machine call its inventor dumb? Isaiah 33:10. But the Lord says, I will stand up and show my power and might. Isaiah 39:6. The time is coming when everything you have, all the treasures stored up by your fathers, will be carried off to Babylon. Nothing will be left. Isaiah 44:24. The Lord your Redeemer who made you says, all things were made by me. I alone stretched out the heavens by myself. I made the earth and everything in it. Isaiah 59:8. You don't know what true peace is, nor what it means to be just and good. You continually do wrong, and those who follow you won't experience my peace either. Isaiah 66:24. And they shall go out and look at the dead bodies of those who have rebelled against me, for their worm shall never die, their fire shall not be quenched, and they shall be a disgusting sight to all mankind. A counselor must be adept at noticing when the person who is affected by the narcissistic self-centered spirit aggrandizes themselves. When they directly or indirectly indicate that they are superior to someone, it is important when the counselor notices the slightest expression of superiority that they immediately, directly, and swiftly knock it down. The counselor must understand that it is a person's inflated sense of self and belief that they are grand and superior to others that causes them a great amount of emotional pain. The person constantly wants and expects to be entitled to the things that they do not deserve. They will attempt to play this game with the counselor by doing things such as making an excuse that they cannot pay the counselor that day. A counselor should never let them slide. Never let them slide. Never! Do not give them any slack when it comes to entitlement. Not one bit of slack when it comes to entitlement. The counselor must send a clear message that if this person believes they are entitled to anything of the counselor's, that they need to take a walk and not come back. And that includes the counselor's time and the counselor's money. Do not let this person borrow anything, even if the counselor doesn't mind giving it to them. Even small things like a pen or a pencil must never be given to this person, otherwise it feeds into their pathological belief that they are entitled. If this person does not show up for an appointment, the counselor should never accept any excuse and not reschedule any more appointments unless the person agrees to pay full price for the missed counseling session. We live in a digital age where most people have a cell phone and it only takes a few seconds to telephone the counselor and cancel an appointment. Do not play this game. They want, I want, I want, I deserve, I deserve, I'm entitled, I'm entitled. The game is endless. Don't play it. When the counselor sets strict boundaries, it will cause this person to fly into a narcissistic rage. This is why it is important for the counselor to model the prophet Isaiah in their approach when counseling this person. Otherwise, if this person does not fear the counselor, they will give themselves all kinds of twisted reasons to try to destroy the counselor. Any counselor who works with a person who has dwelt this horribly wicked narcissistic self-centered spirit will become the object of the narcissist's envy, and they will be in serious trouble if they have come across this weak and wimpy during the counseling session. It is doubtful that they will attempt to do harm to the counselor physically. What they will do is a narcissistic person. They will assassinate the counselor's character and intentionally spend great amounts of time doing premeditated smear campaigns. The counselor must understand that this person is a mentally and spiritually sick individual. They are ruthless, cold, and self-serving, and they have no empathy. In a addition, they are extreme control freaks. Control freak! When the counselor does not play their game, they lose control. And this has a devastating effect on their sense of being special. It is like they fell out of an airplane without a parachute. This seems pretty dramatic that a person would be so hostile, unforgiving, and revengeful for something as simple as the counselor did not let them walk away with a 5-cent pencil or pen. It doesn't seem to make sense that a person who appears to be in self-control, educated, confident, social, and oftentimes charming can turn into this worldly, oh, wicked monster! No matter how this person comes across, it is just a front, and their ultimate goal is to overpower and control the counselor. A good way to understand is for the counselor to imagine that they had no integrity, no empathy, and no social conscience. They believe the rules that apply to everybody else should not apply to them. It is not uncommon for this person to actually expect the counselor to pay them for coming to the counseling session. During the counseling session, one of the tricks they use is to start asking the counselor personal questions and try to change the dynamic of the relationship where they are the one doing the counseling. If the counselor shares their own personal problems with this person, they are making a serious mistake. Should this person ever say to the counselor, perhaps you should be paying me, when the counselor has really messed up, this individual is not interested in having a professional, authentic, therapeutic relationship with the counselor. What they are looking for is a counselor who will boost their fragile ego, and there are plenty of counselors who will do this because they do not understand how this evil, wicked spirit works. A narcissistic self-centered person is constantly on the hunt looking for another person to exploit and feed their narcissistic self-centered spirit. Once they find this person, they will stalk them and prey upon them like a roaring lion that has gone months without food. Their relationship with their newly found prey begins with seducing them. They seduce them by putting on quite an act of showering them with all kinds of attention. Like a chameleon, this person pretends to be the person they finally found, their soulmate. Next, they will try to separate their prey from all their family and all their friends. They prey soon falls from grace as the narcissistic person begins harshly devaluing and criticizing them. This person has a difficult time seeing things in shades or percentages and only sees either others as either good or bad. The counselor is now the bad counselor. A counselor who does not know what they are dealing with will be left completely confused and saying to themselves, well, what happened? Counselors who are extremely codependent will be devastated. A person who has dwelt this evil, wicked, narcissistic, self-centered spirit goes from being very charming to being a raging monster. The belt of truth is that by the grace given us, we say to everyone, do not think of yourself more highly than you ought, but think of yourself with sober judgment in accordance with measure of faith God has given you. It's important that we wouldn't dare say that we are as wonderful as others who tell us how important they are, but they are only comparing themselves with each other, using themselves as the standard of measurement. How ignorant! The belt of truth is that we should do nothing out of selfish ambition or vain conceit, but in humility consider others better than ourselves. The Lord says, listen to me, you stubborn evil man, shall the axe boast greater power than the man who uses it? And the Lord says, yes, I will drive you out of office, says the Lord, and pull you down from your high position. We know that it is important, Lord, that you will honor and praise your name, for you are our God. You do such wonderful things. The bout of truth is that we will trust in the Lord God always, for in the Lord Jehovah is our everlasting strength. He humbles the proud and brings the haughty city to dust. Its walls come crashing down. He presents it to the poor and needy for their use. We know of the prophet Isaiah's warning. Oh, woe to those who try to hide our plans from God, who try to keep them in the dark, exerting what they do. God can't see us, they say to themselves. He doesn't know what is going on. How stupid can they be? Isn't he the potter greater than you, the jars he makes? Will you say to him, he didn't make us? Does a machine call its inventor dumb? The Lord says, I will stand up and show my power and might. The time is coming when everything you have, all the treasures stored up by your fathers, will be carried off to Babylon. Nothing will be left, but the Lord, who is our Redeemer, who made us, says, all things were made by me. I alone stretched out the heavens. By myself I made the earth and everything in it. Let's pray. Father, I thank you for making me equal to others in this world. For forgive me, Lord, for times when I have thoughts I was more special than others, or that I deserved any kind of special treatment or an entitlement. I confess that there have been times when I could have given more, but chose not to give more. Thank you, Lord, for helping me not to have vain opinions of myself. Help me, Lord, to make you the center and not myself. I humbly bow down before you, Lord, knowing that I am not worthy of of your grace and mercy. Thank you for your Son, Jesus Christ, through him only in my working. I pray in the name of Jesus. Amen. The next spirit we're going to talk about is the evil, wicked, desirous, yearning spirit. The desirous, yearning spirit. Philippians 1:23, I am torn between the two. I desire to part. I desire to depart and be with Christ, which is better by far. Proverbs 11:23, the desire of the righteous ends only in good, but the hope of the wicked only in wrath. Deuteronomy 5:21, you shall not covet your neighbor's wife. You shall not set your desire on your neighbor's house or land, his manservant or maidservant, his ox or donkey, or anything that belongs to your neighbor. Psalm 84:2, my soul yearns, even faints for the courts of the Lord. My heart and my flesh cry out for the living God. Ephesians 2:3, all of us also lived among them at one time, gratifying the cravings of our sinful nature and following the desires and thought. Like the rest, we were by nature objects of wrath. Proverbs 23:4, do not wear yourselves out to get rich. Have the wisdom to show restraint. Cast but a glance at riches and they are gone, for they will surely sprout rings and fly off to the sky like an eagle. Proverbs 30:8, give me neither poverty nor riches, but give me only my daily bread. Otherwise I may have too much and disown you and say, who is the Lord? Or I may become poor and steal, and so dishonor the name of my God. Luke 12:15, be on your guard against covetousness in any shape or form, for a man's real life in no way depends upon a number of his possessions. Proverbs 10:22, the blessings of the Lord brings wealth without painful toil for it. 1 Timothy 6:9, people who want to get rich fall into temptation and a trap and into many foolish and harmful desires that plunge men into ruin and destruction. A person who has dwelt the evil, wicked, desirous, yearning spirit has an extreme lust of the flesh. They are extremely corrupt, and their purpose and meaning in life is living only to gratify their flesh. A person normally has desires and yearnings, but they are not to the extreme and cause them emotional pain. However, a person who has dwelt the evil, wicked, desirous, yearning spirit has an extreme desirous and yearning for the things of this world that cause them great emotional pain. They do not see that the real things of value are traced to the grace of God. Living only for themselves, this person has a depraved nature and a gross, passionate appetite in which they are slaves. Over the course of their life, they are constantly wanting, desiring, and yearning to satisfy their flesh. Their mind is darkened by the extreme lust of the flesh, and like a bad tree, they produce bad fruit. Fleshly things are those things which satisfy the body. Certain things are part of other human nature, such as the desire to eat, the desire to have sex, and to be physically comfortable. This is our human nature, and there is no way for us to separate from these desires as long as we remain in the flesh and are living human beings on this earth. However, when these desires and yearnings become out of balance and are extreme, they cause a person a lot of emotional pain. The person who has dwelt this horribly evil, wicked spirit constantly craves food, craves sex, and craves to be materially wealthy, and they crave to have the greatest comforts in life. There is nothing inherently wrong with craving food or sex and wanting to be comfortable, but when a person is constantly craving food and or sex in order to be comfortable, it causes serious problems. Constantly craving sex can lead a person to commit adultery, and the constant craving for food can cause a person to be a glutton, and the constant craving for comfort can cause a person to be greedy. The flesh doesn't operate on reason, and when a person is completely consumed with cravings to satisfy their flesh, they do not think rational thoughts. It is often as though all the blood has left their brain and went to the fleshly organs that crave satisfaction. There is much lust in the eyes, as many would say, that they could not help it. That steak looked delicious, or that fleshly body looked irresistible, or that expensive car looked really comfortable. The person who has dwelt this evil, wicked, desirous, yearning spirit has difficulty controlling their impulses. Impulsively doing the will of the flesh can result in gross and brutal sins, and the person becoming extremely diabolical and wicked. The majority of the world customarily box in their gross fleshly sins. Very few people seem to have any restraints, and if it feels good, do it. As a result, many people are overweight, and many people have sex outside of marriage. Blind impulses of the flesh are completely independent of God, and there is no desire for spiritual pleasure.
pleasures. A person like a hungry lion is greedy with an intense desire for its prey. When the desires of the body or flesh comes to rest, the heart and the soul has an increased desire and longing for communion with God. Our entire mind, body, and soul were made to serve God and to worship God. Singing and rejoicing unto the Lord is a cry of earnest longing and desire for the living God. A person who has dwelt this evil, wicked, desirous, yearning spirit falls into a trap of wanting and desiring something that belongs to another person, such as their property. The Lord says that we should not desire our neighbor's life, house, field, servants, or doggy, or anything that is our neighbor. A counselor encourages a person dwelt with this evil, wicked spirit that desiring all these things that we do not have causes us to feel very negative. When we have received salvation through our Lord Jesus Christ, we have already received everything that is good. When a person is dwelt this spirit, it is harder and harder. They become violent in their pursuits. They may violently pursue another person's spouse or violently pursue taking another person's house. The more desirous and yearning they become, the more hypocritical and double-dealing they become. Having their strong desires and yearning without God is like a ship out to sea without an anchor. Counseling helps this person understand that if they continue living in this world with unrestrained carnal fleshly desires, in the end, they will leave this world with a desire to die because they have been pressed with emotional pain. They are sick of this world, and they have morbid feelings of disappointment and an accumulation of many sorrows. Their desire to leave this world is because they hate others. They have mental and bodily sorrows, and they are completely dissatisfied with the world. By seeking a strong relationship with God, a person ardently loves others. They have no desire to die because of disappointments and the accumulation of material wealth or honor because they don't sought after these things. They will not desire to die because of their lack of being successful in the world, or even because of the pains of being imprisoned, or because they are old and sick or a burden to others. The only desire would be to be motivated by a person's relationship to the Savior and the longing and desire to be with Jesus. This would be a person's only true reason to want to be away from this world. To be with Christ and in His presence is the only reason a person desires to die. Oh, what a difference for one to die only to be with Christ versus wanting to die because one is just sick of life. A person who has dwelt this evil, wicked, desirous, yearning spirit is usually in a great amount of debt. They usually end up having serious debt problems that have led to disastrous consequences in their life because of their extremely strong fleshly desires. Their expenses oftentimes exceed their income. Divorce is common among those who have strong fleshly desires because they end up being stressed and under extreme financial strain. A person who is consumed by their fleshly desire usually has difficulty managing money. They get addicted to gambling, seldom save any money, and because of their stress, they have increased medical expenses. Credit cards become a curse for those who are dwelt with this evil, wicked spirit. They often charge items that they really cannot afford because of the constant urge to use their credit card for things they really do not need. Credit cards make it easy for this person to be compulsively shopping, and their pleasant feelings they feel when they purchase something is disconnected to the unpleasant feelings that come when they don't have the money to make the payment on the credit card. A person who is unable to control their temptations of the flesh obtains a credit card, which allows them to have whatever they want, even though they can't afford it, and then they have yearned and yearned. This person oftentimes pretends to be wealthy and ends up being in a huge financial mess, having a strong desire for a big house, a big luxury car, a big fancy electronic gadget, which a person cannot afford causes them to go into huge financial debt. The person is now a slave and works for the lender, and many go into their entire life never to be free from the lender. A person who has dwelt the evil, wicked, desirous spirit is unlike to acquire riches by being an honest person. Once they become entangled in this narrow of wanting so badly to be rich, it is very difficult for them to escape. There are those who are dwelt this evil, wicked, desirous, yearning spirit who are bound and determined to become materially wealthy. Their entire aim in life is to get the money. Get the money. Save all they can. Keep all they can get. This person seeks to get materially wealthy by honest means, and they do their best not to be foolish with their money. And they want to become the lender instead of the borrower. Unlike a person who has dwelt this evil, wicked spirit and goes into debt prison, they are very careful not to fall into the snares of temptation. Their eventual perdition can be just as dangerous if they choose not to be wisely generous and cling madly to their wealth and money as their god. The things of this world are in a constant change and are driven by winds, waves, tides, and at any moment a person's money can be engulfed in a pit thrown against the rocks. There are materially wealthy persons who are God-fearing and God-loving and do much good with their material wealth, and they are freed from this extremely wicked, desirous, yearning spirit. They are not drawn away by or overcome by their money, unlike those who fall into Satan's trap and commit all kinds of injustices in order to get rich, such as theft, murder, violence, oppressing the poor, lying, defrauding, and many others. The belt of truth is the desire of the righteous ends up only in good, but the hope of the wicked only wrath. We know that we shall not covet our neighbor's spouse. We shall not set our desire on our neighbor's house or land, deserve man servant or maid servant, their ox or donkey, or anything that belongs to our neighbor. Our soul yearns, even faints, for the courts of the Lord. Our heart and our flesh cry out to the living God. We know that it is difficult to refrain from gratifying the cravings of our sinful nature and following its desires and thoughts like the rest. We were by nature objects of wrath. The belt of truth is that it is not wise to air ourselves out to get rich. Have the wisdom to show restraint. Cast but a glance at riches and they are gone, for they surely will sprout wings and fly off to the sky like an eagle. It is important that we neither receive poverty nor riches, but receive only our daily bread. Otherwise, we may have too much and disown the Lord and say, "Who is the Lord?" Or we may become poor and steal and to dishonor the name of God. We are on our guard against covetousness in any shape or form, for a man's real life is in no way dependent upon the number of his possessions. The blessings of the Lord bring wealth without painful toil for it. We know that those who want to get rich fall into temptation and a trap and into many foolish and harmful desires that plunge them into ruin and destruction. Let's pray. Father, I thank you for making me desirous and yearning for you. Forgive me, Lord, for times when I have had only desires and yearnings for the things of this world and only to please my flesh. Lord, consume me with the desire to please you. Thank you, Lord, for helping me control and refrain from my desires only to please myself. Lord, you are my anchor. You are my rock. Father, I pray that whatever my income in this world, that my debt always remain less and I remain free from the lender. Thank you for your son, Jesus Christ. My soul yearns and cries out for your courts, Lord. I pray in the name of Jesus. Amen. Another spirit that is part of the evil, wicked, selfish, stubborn, jealous spirit is the evil, wicked, gluttonous spirit. Proverbs 23:2. If you are a big eater, put a knife to your throat. Numbers 11:34. Therefore, the place was named Kibroth Hattaavah, because there they buried the people who had craved other food. Ezekiel 16:49. Sodom's sins were pride, gluttony, and laziness, while the poor and needy suffered outside her door. 2 Peter 2:10. This is especially true of those who follow the corrupt desire of their sinful nature and despise authority. Bold and arrogant, these men are not afraid to slander celestial beings. James 5:5. You have spent your years on earth in luxury, satisfying your every desire. You have fattened yourself for the day of slaughter. 1 Timothy 5:6. But the widow who lives only for pleasure is spiritually dead even while she lives. James 1:4. Each one is tempted when he is drawn away by his own desire and enticed. Then when desire has conceived, it gives birth to sin, and sin, when it is full grown, brings forth death. Proverbs 23:20. Do not mix with wine bibbers or with gluttonous eaters of meat. James 4:1. Where do wars and fights come from among you? Do they not come from your desires for pleasure that war in your members? You lust and do not have. You murder and covet and cannot obtain. A person who has dwelt in evil, wicked, gluttonous spirit is headed for utter destruction. They have made their appetite their god. Gluttony is the mother of lust, and persons dwell with this evil, wicked spirit claim that it is beyond their control. It is also also considered one of the seven deadly sins. Whenever we hear the word gluttony, we associate it with overeating, but gluttony manifests itself in several other ways. Gluttony is basically a defiance of a reasonably balanced behavior. It occurs when a person overindulges themselves in something that is not healthy spiritually, mentally, or physically. They may be a glutton and have an insatiable appetite for several objects. Greedily, they desire to satisfy their lust for an object or objects compulsively to the point of physically and spiritual death. A person dwelt with this evil, wicked, gluttonous spirit has no discipline when it comes to restraint. Restraint! There is a major war between the flesh and the spirit. This is a blinding, evil, wicked spirit, as many who are gluttonous are not aware of their gluttony. In order to overcome this evil, and deadly, this person has to become aware that they are dwelt this spirit. Once a person becomes aware that they are a glutton, once they become aware that they are a glutton, then they learn that giving into their desire is harmful. This person is experiencing an extreme war between the flesh and the spirit, and they often lack the self-control needed to resist. It doesn't take much learning to understand that being a glutton is emotionally, physically, and spiritually unhealthy. Temperance is the fruit of the spirit that overcomes gluttony. Food is often the object of glutton. However, many people argue that overeating is not the same as being a glutton. Many people overeat, and many would agree that obesity leads to a poorer health and deadly diseases such as high blood pressure, heart disease, and diabetes. However, gluttony doesn't repeat overindulgence of any type of behavior that harms a person physically, emotionally, and spiritually. When a person overindulges in such things as eating too much food, they tend to make poor decisions. A counselor helps this person by encouraging them to become aware and confess it. Confess it. Confess that you're a glutton. Confess it. That they have been a glutton. You have been a glutton. Confess it. Confess it. Then the person makes a commitment to die to this old nature and walk in the newness of life. This dying of the old nature is not just a one-time act. It is something a person struggles with daily. Prayer is the most important intervention, and the counselor encourages this person to pray in the morning, pray throughout the day. If they should wake up in the middle of the night and want to eat, first thing they should do is pray. The counselor also encourages this person to get involved in a Bible study group that includes reading and discussing God's word. Doing these activities is called sowing the spirit. Sowing the spirit. A person gradually changes from sowing the flesh to sowing the spirit, and this is done through prayer, reading, and discussing the word of God and fellowship with other believers. The Lord says that we should have self-control in all things, have godliness with contentment, and be patient in our doing. Many people live in pleasure on this earth. We have luxury cars, luxury houses, luxury, 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 luxury technology, luxury communication, luxury food, luxury services, luxury, 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 luxury. A person dwelt with this evil, wicked, gluttonous spirit indulges freely in eating and drinking, and they pamper their appetite continually. If a person occasionally pampers their appetite, they are not necessarily a glutton. However, if they are pampering their appetite continuously, they are certainly a glutton. Their gluttony may seem normal to them, but to others it is grossly gluttonous. James 5:5. You have lived in pleasure on the earth. This person continually looks for happiness by pleasuring their senses and pampering their stinking body at the expense of their soul. A person does not become dwelt with evil, wicked, gluttonous spirit overnight. Many have a long history of being extremely spoiled as children. The child who gets what they want as a result of bursting into weeping and screaming becomes spoiled. As a child, they threw a fit and flew into a rage when they did not get what they want. And now, as an adult, they expect the same. Men who have a history of being spoiled also tend to be more effeminate. A man who is extremely masculine to the point of behaving like a brute animal also tends to become an extremely out of control glutton. The glutton becomes spiritually and morally dead. On the outside, they live for pleasure. They're very loose and unpredictable, and they serve their lust and pleasures. But on the inside, they are like dead bones. The Bible often refers to two different types of death, which included death of the body and death of the soul. When the body dies, the soul dies, and only God can give life to the soul or spirit after the body dies. A person person who is immoral and or without Christ separates and alienates the soul from God, and their soul is dead. When referring to the soul, dead doesn't necessarily mean that it no longer exists in a living body. A person can be very much alive and have a living body, but their soul or spirit is dead or lifeless. The glutton has a spirit that is deadened or very weak and almost lifeless. The person is not concerned about their unrighteousness nor troubled about it. Like a dead person, they can do nothing for themselves concerning the spiritual grip of gluttony, and they become hurtful and infectious to themselves and others. They're extremely burdened by the sin of gluttony to the point in the spiritual sense they are dead while their body is alive. As this evil, wicked, gluttonous spirit becomes more indwelt, it leads to gross criminal pleasures. The person does anything, whether against the law or not, in order to continue luxurious living and to gratify their sensual pleasures. Fraud is the most common criminal means used by the glutton. They will do whatever it takes to fatten themselves like a stall-fed pig. Seldom do they work. Seldom do they contribute anything to society. Their wealth comes from either criminal activities or whatever they can coddle out of others. They are without care or a forethought of spiritual things because their spirit is lifeless. A person who has dwelt this evil, wicked, gluttonous spirit is a glutton for food. They have a habit of unconsciously gorging themselves when they eat. They gorge and gorge and gorge, and they get bigger and bigger and bigger. They live to eat versus eating to live, and glutton their bodies like beasts. If they have become materially wealthy, they only use their wealth for themselves. A common characteristic of the glutton is that they despise the government. There are many people who do not like the government. However, this person really doesn't like the government. They hate the government. They despise the government to the extreme. They will constantly talk about how evil and wrong the government has dealt them. This is because they want unbridled freedom of many sorts. In their mind, if they could get rid of all authority, they could live in an unrestrained indulgence of their vicious appetites. A glutton is commonly disrespected towards authority figures, and they have no regard for those who deserve honor and splendor. 2 Peter 2:8, these filthy dreamers defile the flesh, despise dominion, and speak evil of dignities. This person has no fear about speaking against God himself in heaven. They are so pleased with themselves, often having very strong opinions, often complaining and murmuring, and they are judgmental and obstinate. Think of the extremely obese people that one has met in their life. The counselor attempts to help this person who has dwelt with this evil, wicked, gluttonous spirit by encouraging them to bring every thought to God's beauty and of Christ, and to stop walking after the flesh. A physical indication that the gluttonous person has been touched by the Spirit of God is that they will start trembling once they realize that they are not free from serious consequences that result in the afterworld to those who boldly gratify their sinful lusts, like the city of Sodom, which was full of people who engaged in all kinds of sinful lusts, lived in luxury, were idle, hated authority, disobeyed God, and extremely selfish and greedy. They will sink into a bottomless pit. Most individuals who are gluttonous live in situations where they have plenty. They live in a land of plenty. They have always had plenty of food, plenty of drink, plenty of luxuries. Luxury, 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 luxury. Many are in situations where they have an abundance of idleness and don't even have to work. Their life is easy, secure, and they can do whatever they please at their leisure without labor. The counselor carefully works with this person and greatly encourages that they pray. A counselor should make sure to point out the importance of praying for God's will. Thy will be done. When praying, the glutton calmly prays for God to give them more and more of this and more of that and more of that and more of this. And to answer their prayer, it would cause them complete ruin and destruction. During the first century, the Israelites said that the gluttons were buried in graves of lust at particular grave sites. Only those who died as a result of their gluttony were buried there. A glutton may have been granted their desire, but God grants the desires of sinners in wrath. God's word says that to be free with the amounts of food and drink one eats is like cutting one's own throat. The world is full of temptations, especially with food and drink. A person is enticed and tempted constantly with all forms of communication and advertisement to eat, spend, and gorge. Then along comes the holidays with tons and tons and tons of food and drink. No longer is there one size, but now there is super size and super duper duper whooper size. The temptations are great, and even the strongest willed people have great difficulty. However, a person is responsible for their actions and the choices they make. Through the power of God's Spirit, a person who lacks self-control and self-discipline is able to gain control. Proverbs 23:1, when you sit down to eat with a ruler, consider carefully what is before you, and put a knife to your throat if you are a man given to appetite. This is because gluttony is considered by God to be very evil. A counselor also encouraged this person to not spend too much time around others who are gluttonous. Hanging around others who are gluttonous causes a person to become gluttonous. Thessalonians 3:6, we command you, brethren, in the name of the Lord Jesus, that you withdraw from every brother who walks disorderly and not according to the traditions which he received from us. A gluttonous person could be said to be searching for God on a physical level, as indicated by their extreme devotion to food and drink. Some will even make an excuse that God created food and drink for them to enjoy seeing, smelling, and tasting. There are many physical things in the world that God created for persons to enjoy, but there is no excuse to be a glutton. A food glutton has made their belly their God and has placed their belly as being more important than serving God. Being a glutton is like committing a slow suicide. A person who eats and drinks excessively usually does not have a long life. Giving in to excessive desire, especially of food, usually doesn't hurt a person immediately, but over time it causes serious health risks. The counselor can help this person by having them think about a salesman who is too eager, wants to sell them too much, wants them to buy too quickly, and his price is very expensive. How would they size a salesman? Would a bell sound in their mind that giving in to the salesman could be dangerous? Would it be any different with food? If a person wants to buy food too quickly, buy a lot of food, buy expensive food, or is very eager to eat food. The food glutton oftentimes thinks about meals several hours beforehand. They even think about the sauces and seasonings. There is nothing wrong with experiencing pleasure when satisfying the palate. However, when a person eats only to satisfy the palate and it is their only motive to eat, it is very sinful and a sign of gluttony. The oldest sin is eating, as indicated in the fall of man when Adam and Eve ate the forbidden fruit. A food glutton can even become very deceptive in the ways they feed themselves. They will even steal food from stores, not because they cannot afford to pay for it, but because of fear or embarrassment that someone may see them buying more food. They do all kinds of deceitful and deceptive things to satisfy their extreme craving for food, such as stealing their roommate's food, driving several miles to obtain fast food from the same fast food establishment but in a different location, eating entire packages of food in one setting that would last the normal person a week. Satan and his evil wicked spirits will try to convince a person dwelt with his evil wicked gluttony spirit that it's really not that bad. Look around and see that most everybody else is overweight. Being extremely overweight as a result of this gluttony spirit is a very big deal and a very big sin. Many times this person suffers from deep shame. They cannot even discuss it in public. They have to hide and undertake their sex affair with food in secret. Food gluttony is extremely hideous, and for a person whose eating is clearly out of control, they are left with a horrendous burden of self-hate, anguish, and guilt. Foods such as chocolate, cookies, ice cream, and fried foods are this person's enemy, and they love them. They love them and can't resist staying away from the enemy. The counselor assists this person in learning to accept and love themselves as they are at the present time. They are encouraged to love, care for, and accept their body no matter how much they are overweight. Hating, distrusting, and despising one's body only feeds into this evil, wicked, gluttonous spirit and causes a person to increase their gluttony of food. Grace gives life and works destroy life. The next step is for this person to not eat unless they are hungry and to stop eating when they are full. Many times this person eats way beyond the point of satisfying their hunger. A counselor encourages this person to let go and surrender and to increase their faith and trust in Jesus Christ. It is also important for the counselor to understand that a thin person can also be just as much a food glutton as a large overweight person, it is possible to eat moderately and still be obese. Some people have a very fast metabolism while other people have very slow metabolism. Gluttony of food has to do with behavior of the person and not the size of the person. Some behaviors that the counselor observes and assesses to determine if food gluttony is a culprit includes determining if the person is obsessed with food and how often and how much they consume. The counselor encourages this person that attending to the health of one's body is an important stewardship towards God. There needs to be an imbalance as to much focusing on the health of one's body leads to worldliness, and not enough focus on the health of one's body can lead to gluttony, which results in physical, psychological, social, spiritual problems. Feasting and fasting can both be an act of devotion to God. A counselor must keep in mind that gluttony is an evil, wicked spirit that commonly manifests itself in unhealthy eating habits. A person may have started out innocently eating unhealthy, and the more times they did it, the more they opened the door for the evil, wicked spirit of gluttony to enter. In the beginning, they may have started out as eating just a little bit too much on occasion, and once the demon of gluttony dwelt in their spirit of this individual, they started to crave and compulsively eating food. A sign that this person has dwelt in evil, wicked, gluttonous spirit is the amount of distress they feel when they are not able to eat food, when they have a craving or a compulsion to eat. Another sign is that the person fantasizes about food quite often and believes food will make them happy. The higher degree this evil, wicked spirit has controlled this person, the more sad, lonely, nervous, fearful, and stressed out they become when they are unable to satisfy their craving to eat. They may start isolating themselves and hiding from the world while eating large amounts of food. A person who has dwelt the evil, wicked spirit of gluttony is in severe psychological pain, and they will eventually eat themselves to death. There is a stereotype that many people who attend church are gluttons, as indicated by a large number of people who attend church being overweight. Secular counselors and psychologists claim that many people who attend church are overweight because they are sexually repressed. Eating is psychoanalyzed as an outlet for their sexually repressed feelings. It is not okay to make love or have sex with another human being outside of marriage, according to God's word. Also, it is not okay to be a glutton. Perhaps it would be important for those who preach the gospel to remind people that gluttony is a horribly wicked sin. The counselor encourages this person that God can deliver them from this evil, wicked spirit. Once they are delivered, it is important that they work on changing their behavior, increasing their coping skills, and working on unresolved issues. There are more than likely several unresolved wounds that this person has experienced throughout their life that have been repressed by the food. Primary goal is for this person to let go and trust God. They must change from wanting to please their palate to wanting to please God. A counselor also encourages this person to read the Bible and memorize certain verses that can be of great use in coping when they have intense cravings for food. This person may really hate themselves and see themselves as filthy, disgusting pigs. Their worth as a person is greatly impacted by their beliefs. They are often extremely embarrassed and ashamed of their body. A counselor emphasizes that God loves the person because of their heart and not because of their body. A counselor emphasizes that God loves the person because of their heart and not because of their appearance. God does want to help us overcome sin of gluttony, and he gives us the power through the sacrifice that Jesus made on the cross. Without the power of God, this evil, wicked demon will continually distort and twist the person's thoughts and convince them that there is no use. They might as well give up, and no one will ever love them. They are gross and disgusting, and they are a fat pig and a big fat slob. A person must continually dispute these distorted, twisted thoughts that are all lies. There is a use because God wants to use me in his ministry. The Lord never gives up on me, and I will never give up on him. God loves me for what's in my heart and not because of my appearance. My body is the temple of the Holy Spirit, and anywhere God's spirit dwells is not gross, and I am not a fat pig or a
slob. I am a child of God.
Gluttony is not only considered a sin, but it is considered a selfish sin. Gluttony does not only include food, but includes many other things that a person wants in excess. For instance, drinking too much alcohol in excess, smoking too many cigarettes in excess, too much sex in excess, or doing anything that brings pleasure in excess. A gluttonous person may sacrifice many other pleasures in exchange for just one pleasure. A person who suffers from a mental disorder called bulimia has been dwelt the evil wicked spirit of gluttony. They will eat large amounts of food and then throw up so they can eat more and more and then throw up and then eat more and more and throw up and vomit and eat more and throw up and vomit. There are many other issues involved in this disorder of bulimia. However, the primary root evil wicked spirit is the gluttonous spirit. A gluttonous person will complain about anything if it causes them any discomfort. God would say to them, he never promised them a rose garden, and life is uncomfortable at times, so get over it! Suffering can make a person stronger. The gluttonous person will insist on being pampered. There are people who will actually want to kill themselves because their credit cards are taken away from them. Oh, you poor, you sorry thing, you. Your poor, sorry thing, your credit card was taken away. Oh, I feel so bad for you. A person can also be a glutton of people's time. When they experience enjoyment and pleasure of being with another person, they want more and more and more and more and more of the person's time. Eventually, they drive the other person away because they won't give them any space. Being like a fish that constantly goes, a gulp, a gulp, a gulp. It's no way to live to be like a fish that constantly goes, gulp, 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 gulp. That's no way to live. A counselor must understand that a person's gluttonous behavior usually becomes with a thought. These thoughts then become pictures in the person's mind. These pictures in the person's mind then increase the person's desire. Then the person is faced with making a decision, and their actions or behavior depends on the decision they make. Here is a breakdown of how this works in real life. A person has a thought that the 2 quarter pounders with cheese for the price of one at a popular fast food restaurant as advertised on the radio is a really good bargain. Then they see a picture in their mind of the 2 quarter pounders with cheese, and they may even see themselves driving to the restaurant and ordering the 2 quarter pounders with cheese. Seeing these pictures in their mind starts building their desire to purchase these 2 quarter pounders with cheese for the price of one, which they think is a really good bargain. The more they think about it and think about it and thinking about it, then they start getting this picture in their mind of 2 quarter pounders with cheese. Sins in their mind then sins into their desire. They either make a decision to go or not to go to the fast food restaurant and purchase the 2 quarter pounders with cheese for the price of one. A counselor encourages this person to change their thoughts so it does not create this picture in their mind. Instead, they need to create a picture from their thoughts that decrease their desire. The counselor needs to understand that thought stopping or trying not to think about something does not work. It actually causes the opposite to occur. The more a person tries to stop thinking about something, the more they think about it. Galatians 5:22, but the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. There are some people who claim they overeat because of stress, and eating helps them cope with stress. Therefore, it is also important for the counselor to incorporate stress management techniques as a way for this person to relieve stress. This includes relaxation training such as controlled breathing, stretching, exercising, and progressive muscle relaxation. A gluttonous person is usually extremely wasteful and has a lack of gratitude. This is another area the counselor should address during the counseling process. Procrastination is a common symptom among the person who has dwelt the evil, wicked, gluttonous spirit. They are many who claim they will stop being gluttonous tomorrow. I'll stop being gluttonous after the holidays. Proverbs 27:1, boast not thyself of tomorrow, for thou knowest not what a day may bring forth. This person seldom ever delays gratifying their palate or getting their pleasures fulfilled, but they will continually delay working on the problem. They have a long list of excuses why they they can't begin resisting their craving for pleasure today. This person will despise anyone who tries to get them to accept responsibility. It is always somebody else's fault, or it is because they have a fat gene, and etc., which is not their fault. It's not my fault. I have a fat gene. I have a fat gene. It's not my fault. I can't control my eating. I just get fat even when I just smell food. The devil made me do it. The devil made me do it. This person does not have the power within themselves to change, and therefore they must rely on the power of God, which is a greater than themselves, to help them change. The counselor encourages this person that it is important to start today. Accept responsibility and not blame others. To trust that God has the power to help us change, and to stay away from pleasures that we know will tempt us. A person who has a problem with food gluttony does not tempt themselves by getting a membership at a wholesale grocery store where food is brought in large quantities. Ephesians 4:27. Neither give place to the devil. Replace the bad with the good, such as instead of having a wholesale membership at the grocery store, replace it with a wholesale membership at the gym. Philippians 4:8. Finally, brethren, whatever things are true, whatever things are honest, whatever things are just, whatever things are pure, whatever things are lovely, whatever things are of good report, if there be any virtue, and if there be any praise, think on these things. Romans 12:2. And be not conformed to this world, but ye transformed by the renewing of your mind, and ye may prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God. People who are overweight, and especially those who are extremely overweight, are treated much differently by society than those who are not overweight. The overweight person is often stereotyped as being lazy, having no motivation, and having no discipline. Their wages are usually lower and promotions are fewer. The majority of society has a lot of hate towards people who are overweight. Incredibly, many are just as overweight as the person they are making fun of and hating for being overweight. A person who is short in stature is going to appear more overweight than a person who is taller in stature. The taller person who may be 80 pounds overweight makes fun of and hates the shorter person who is only 50 pounds overweight. They cannot see themselves. The stigma of being overweight can be very harsh. Overweight women are more stigmatized and discriminated against than overweight men. The bout of truth is this, that if we are a big eater, we should put a stop to it, as there was a place named Kibroth Hattaavah, because there they buried the people who had craved other food. We know that the city of Sodom's sins were pride, gluttony, laziness, while the poor and needy suffered outside her door. There are those who have spent years on earth in luxury, satisfying their desire. They have fattened themselves for the day of slaughter, but the widow who lives only for pleasure is spiritually dead even while she lives. The bout of truth is that everyone who is tempted and drawn away by their own desire and enticed gives birth to sin, and sin, when it is full grown, brings forth death. But we choose not to mix with wine bibbers or with gluttonous eaters of meat. We know that wars and fights among us come from our desires for pleasure that war in us, and the lust of things we do not have. The bout of truth is that finally, brethren, whatsoever things are true, whatsoever things are honest, whatsoever things are just, whatsoever things are pure, whatsoever things are lovely, whatsoever things are of good report, if there be any virtue, and if there be any praise, think on these things, and be not conformed to this world, but be ye transformed by the renewing of your mind, that ye may prove what is good and acceptable and perfect will of God. Let's pray. Father, I thank you for all of your measures. Forgive me, Lord, for times when I have been a glutton and engaged in behaviors that are physically, mentally, socially, and spiritually unhealthy. Lord, when I get a desire to eat more than I need, help me refrain and keep a balanced diet. Thank you, Lord, for helping me be more aware of when I am being a glutton. Lord, you are my bread. You are my substance. Father, I pray that I overcome this old nature that is very unhealthy and begin walking a new life. Thank you. Thank you, Lord, for the redeeming blood of your Son, Jesus. Thank you, Lord, for the redeeming blood of your Son, Jesus. Father, I thank you for giving me the ability to have self-control in all the areas, to have godliness with contentment and patience in all I do. I pray in the name of Jesus. Amen.